Calorama, a Recorded Books Hybrid imprint, presents The Centrist Solution, How We Made Government Work and Can Make It Work Again, by Senator Joseph I. Lieberman. Read by Rich Miller. Introduction. The Nightmares of John Adams. There is nothing I dread so much as a division of the Republic into two great parties, each arranged under its leader, and concerting measures in opposition to each other. This, in my humble apprehension, is to be dreaded as the greatest political evil under our Constitution. John Adams, Second President of the United States. For the last few decades, the American people have been living through what John Adams considered the greatest political evil under our Constitution, and our country has suffered greatly. In this dreaded nightmare, we have become more divided. Our largest problems remain unsolved, and our international leadership has been compromised. For the future of our country and our children, we must find a way to do better. I have written this book with the goal of helping our leaders and the people who elect them find that better way. Within this book, I will share stories that illustrate what I learned during 40 years in elective office, 24 in the U.S. Senate, about how to make America's government work. This book is a call for the restoration of bipartisanship and centrism to Washington. When put into practice, those methods have always enabled our democracy to function best. Centrism is not an ideology like liberalism, conservatism, socialism, or fascism. It is a strategy for how to govern in a democracy. It is the bringing together of people from different parties and ideologies to genuinely listen to each other, so they can negotiate compromises and get things done for their constituents and country. The ideologies and priorities of the Republican and Democratic parties have naturally changed over the course of American history, but the need for bipartisanship and centrism to bring them together has not. It remains the best, often the only, way for democratic governments to produce results. Centrism is not the same as moderation. However, being a moderate makes it easier to find the way to the center, because most moderates are already there on matters of policy. Centrism is anathema to extremists of the left and right, because getting together in the center requires that they compromise, which they abhor. They don't understand that the compromises required in the problem-solving center are not compromises of principle, morality, or ethics. As I learned in my 10 years in the state Senate and 24 in the U.S. Senate, the big choices are not between right and wrong. They are between solving problems or having another futile political fight. Between demanding 100% of what you want or engaging in some give and take with the other party to actually get something done. Here is a simplistic illustration of my point in the area of economic policy. The far right argues for pure free market capitalism with no governmental involvement. The far left argues that the government itself should control most of the economy. Center-left and center-right leaders avoid those extremes and find a common ground that preserves private property ownership and free markets, but regulates them to protect the public interest. Centrists understand these words from the Talmud. Without governments, people would treat each other like fish. The big ones would eat the little ones. But centrists also remember Winston Churchill's wisdom. Some regard private enterprise as if it were a predatory tiger to be shot. Others look upon it as a cow they can milk. A handful see it for what it really is, the strong horse that pulls the whole cart. It's no coincidence that I chose private enterprise and a quotation from Winston Churchill in my illustration of centrism. One is a hallmark of democratic nations, and the other is a man who spent a lifetime in government service under a parliamentary democracy. Both were bulwarks against dictatorships. Centrism is irrelevant in a dictatorship, because the dictator stifles all differences of opinion. But in a democracy, centrism is essential. Why? Because in democracies, the perpetual challenge is to form a majority from the multitude of parties, factions, and opinions that freedom of speech, assembly, religion, conscience, and more, makes possible. It's valuable to look back at American history, which shows how important centrism has been to our national journey, beginning with the critical compromises that allowed our founders to reach agreement at the Constitutional Convention to form our government and protect our independence. I will do that in Chapter 1. As I look back on my 2+ decades in the U.S. Senate, all of the important legislation I helped enact began and ended in the bipartisan center. I will describe the legislative products I am most proud of later. They span a wide spectrum of policy, including the Clean Air Act of 1990, the legislative campaign to support American military action to stop post-Cold War aggression and genocide in the Balkans, the creation of the Department of Homeland Security, and the reform of America's intelligence agencies after the terrorist attacks of 9/11-2001, the Balanced Budget Act of 1997, made possible by the odd couple centrist partnership of President Bill Clinton and Speaker of the House of Representatives Newt Gingrich, and the repeal of the anti-gay Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy in our military, which I co-sponsored with my Republican colleague, Senator Susan Collins of Maine. My centrism also helped give me some of the most unexpected political opportunities of my career, such as being asked by Al Gore to be his vice presidential running mate on the Democratic ticket in 2000, then 8 years later being vetted by John McCain to be his running mate on the Republican ticket. Bipartisanship and centrism also caused a lot of political controversy and upheaval in my career, and that's another part of the story I want to tell. For example, my position on one issue during the George W. Bush administration, my opposition to Democratic demands that the president withdraw American troops from Iraq, led to a Democratic primary against me in 2006. I lost, but was re-elected as an independent. America's freedom, security, and prosperity depend on a healthy political center, a center that avoids chaotic and self-destructive extremes, and instead produces progress and stability. On public opinion poll after public opinion poll, the American people show they understand these truths. Large majorities say they prefer elected officials who are willing to compromise with the other party to solve problems, rather than sticking absolutely to policy positions they have endorsed in their campaigns. And yet, the representatives who the voters elect to lead them in Congress and the White House seem more frequently to avoid the center like it was a hot zone of infectious disease. After the presidential election of 2020, Mark Penn, chairman of the Harris Poll, which is among the oldest and most prestigious trackers of American opinion and social sentiment, wrote, "We are one country divided by two parties. America remains primarily a moderate centrist country in which, as Penn explains, most voters prefer compromise on health care, immigration, and other thorny issues that the extremes of the parties have pushed to the limits." As the Harris exit polls show, the election of Joe Biden as our 46th president was, in good measure, a victory of centrists over the partisan and ideological extremes. Almost all self-identified liberals, 23% of all voters, voted for Biden, and almost all conservatives, 38% of all voters, voted for Trump. It was the moderates, the centrists, also 38% of all voters, who made the difference. In 2016, Hillary Clinton carried self-identified moderate voters by 12 points, but in 2020, Biden carried them by 30 points, an enormous 18% increase that helped decide the election. In some very encouraging ways, the 2020 election can be seen as a centrist uprising against partisan and ideological divisions, harsh personal rhetoric, and the resulting governmental gridlock in Washington. It is also true, however, that President Trump ran way ahead of the predictions of most pollsters in 2020, receiving more than 74 million votes, and in 15 battleground states, actually running more than a million votes ahead of Biden. Many Republican candidates for Congress and state offices who are loyal to Trump did even better. They got elected. In fact, the number of Republicans and Democrats who took the Senate or House oath of office to serve in January 2021 was almost even. It also seems clear that President Trump intends to remain the leader of the Republican Party at least until 2024, which will definitely work against it becoming more centrist. In sum, there is compelling evidence from the 2020 election, in spite of the polling and Joe Biden's centrist election, that shows there is still a big partisan divide in our country. As Mark Penn said, we are one country divided by two parties. There is a lot of work to do before bipartisan centrism is back conclusively in American politics. President Biden has said he is a proud Democrat, but intends to be the president of all Americans, working across party lines in Washington, and hoping thereby to unify the rest of our country. I know from serving in the U.S. Senate with Joe Biden for 24 years that he means what he says. It's what he regularly did in the Senate, and it helped him build an impressive record of legislative accomplishments. Now, President Biden and members of both parties in Congress have to find their way to the center to listen to each other respectfully, negotiate thoughtfully, and compromise productively. It's the only way we will solve some of our serious national problems and seize some of our great national opportunities. It will require Republican members of Congress to break away from Trump, and it will require Biden and Democratic members of Congress to declare their independence from far-left Democrats who won't compromise. I hope the stories in this book and the lessons I draw from the bipartisan successes in which I was privileged to participate during my senatorial career will be helpful to Republican and Democratic elected officials who are fed up with the political dysfunction that has crippled our government and diminished our great country. I know the overwhelming majority of them want to make our government work better again. Bipartisan centrism is the way. That's the pivotal lesson I learned. And so, for all who follow in elective office, I aim to illustrate and emphasize how effective and beneficial our government has been when the voters have received the bipartisan problem-solving they want. I also will offer suggestions about how to close the gap between the dysfunctional and divisive government the American people have endured and the problem-solving, opportunity-creating government they deserve. In the last chapter, I will describe my work with an organization called No Labels, which I have supported since it was founded in 2010. My Senate Chief of Staff, Clarine Nardi Riddle, was one of its five official founders. When I left the Senate in 2013, I became personally active in No Labels, and since 2014 have been its national chair. Today, I believe No Labels has done more than any other political organization to bring America's government back to the bipartisan, problem-solving center. It is one of our best hopes for a brighter American future. 1. The Roots of American Centrism. America's founders were educated in the Greek classics, Judeo-Christian theology, and the philosophy of the Enlightenment, all of which guided their creation of a centrist government. In Greek philosophy, Aristotle held that the middle way between extremes was the best way. Harmony that moderated extremes was the goal. Courage is a favorite example of Aristotle's centrism. Courage is a human virtue, he said, but if taken too far to one side, becomes reckless and dangerous. If it slides too far to the other side, it becomes cowardice, which is also dangerous. The center point of courage, between the cowardly and reckless, is the place to be. Aristotle's lesson is memorably illustrated in Greek mythology. Daedalus builds wax and feather wings for himself and his son Icarus so they can escape the control of King Minos by air. Daedalus instructs Icarus to fly the middle course, between the heat of the sun and the cool of the ocean. But Icarus is infatuated by his ability to fly, and goes higher and higher, closer and closer to the sun, until the wax on his wings melts, the wings separate from his body, and he falls into the sea and drowns. That was a large price to pay for leaving the centrist course. America's founders were well-educated in Greek philosophy and mythology, but it was Judeo-Christian theology that influenced them more. There, they also found great value placed on the center path. In the Talmud, Rabbi Judah offers a parable that reads like Daedalus. There is a highway that runs between two paths, one of fire and the other of snow. If a person walks too close to the fire, this person will be scorched by the flames. If too close to the snow, this person will be bitten by the cold. What is the person to do? This person is to walk in the middle, taking care not to be scorched by the heat nor bitten by the cold. Maimonides, the 12th century Spanish Jewish philosopher and scholar, wrote, "The right way is the mean, namely that disposition that is equally distant from the two extremes in its class." Christian texts are full of appeals for personal and societal moderation as the natural result of living Christian values. Evil consists in discordance from their rule or measure. This may happen by exceeding the measure or falling short of it. Therefore, it is evident that moral virtue observes the mean. St. Thomas Aquinas. "Let your moderation be known unto all men, because the Lord is at hand." Philippians chapter 4, verse 5. "All things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any." 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12. Many leaders among the founding American generation brought to our nation's shores a belief in the Hebrew Bible and the New Testament. The theologian who most influenced them was John Calvin. "There is no kind of government more salutary," Calvin wrote, "than one in which liberty is properly exercised with becoming moderation and properly constituted on a durable basis." Calvin's Protestant Reform theology can be described as centrist, sitting as it does between the extremes of Anabaptist liberalism and Catholic legalism. Although Calvin was a theologian and religious leader, he had strong political views, centrist political views, based on his wonderful phrase, "becoming moderation." "The purpose of political government and law," Calvin said, "is to cultivate civil restraint and righteousness in people, and to promote general peace and liberty." Michael Novak, the Roman Catholic theologian, wrote that the American eagle took flight in the 18th century with two wings. One was the Calvinist faith of the founders, particularly their knowledge and love of the Bible, and the other was the philosophy of the Enlightenment. Our forefathers were very much aware of the Enlightenment's great European philosophers, including Montesquieu, Voltaire, Rousseau, Hume, Locke, and Bacon. Those great thinkers believed in the primacy of reason and embraced the scientific method of their time. Tolerance, particularly religious tolerance, was very important to them. They advocated for a government that upheld civic virtue and protected freedom of religion and speech, as well as individual equality and opportunity. The operative political strategy of the Enlightenment was centrist. In his Spirit of the Law, Montesquieu writes that the essence of his political philosophy is the spirit of moderation. Voltaire's guiding philosophy for government, meanwhile, was one that has been repeated by political centrists since he wrote it in the 18th century. "The perfect is the enemy of good." In other words, the compromises that centrist politics require are the best way to solve society's problems and bring about progress. If you accept only perfection, you will not solve or build anything. Voltaire's pithy statement is not only a wise comment on the general imperfection of the human race, but also an inescapable fact about the impossibility of achieving perfection in the work of political leaders who must find common ground to produce results. The great values of faith and enlightenment motivated and directed our founders as they drafted America's Declaration of Independence in 1776 and our Constitution in 1787. In the case of the Constitution, there were large and fundamental differences of opinion about America's future government that needed to be reconciled. Compromises were therefore imperative to achieve the unity America needed to secure its independence from England. However, there were no disagreements about our founders' purpose in adopting the Declaration of Independence at the Continental Congress at the State House in Philadelphia in the summer of 1776. The resolution for independence from England passed unanimously. Differences of opinion arose around the actual words the delegates chose to explain their declaration, and those choices have greatly influenced American history since. The Declaration preceded the Revolutionary War. America's values were therefore declared before its boundaries were secured, meaning the words chosen for the Declaration were important. They emerged from admirable discussion, negotiation, and compromise among the delegates to the convention. The most important phrases of the 1,337-word Declaration constitute some of the most important words ever written in the English language. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. To make clear how determinative those sentences are, the Declaration immediately goes on to say, "To secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the government." In other words, the new nation was being established for the primary purpose of implementing the Universal Declaration of Human Rights made in the first paragraph. But there was not unanimous support for the words Thomas Jefferson proposed for that pivotal paragraph from the outset. The original language he sent to the other four members of the drafting committee of five, John Adams of Massachusetts, Benjamin Franklin of Pennsylvania, Robert Livingston of New York, and, may I say with some parochial pride, Roger Sherman of Connecticut, was, "We hold these truths to be sacred and undeniable." Franklin asked that the words "sacred and undeniable" be replaced by "self-evident." Why? Walter Isaacson, a great Franklin biographer, believes Franklin was reflecting the philosophy of the Enlightenment, particularly as he had learned it from David Hume, the philosopher with whom he had become friendly during the years he was in London. Franklin wanted the new nation to be founded on rationality, not religion. Everyone, including Jefferson, looked up to Franklin, who was much older and more worldly than the other delegates in Philadelphia. Jefferson himself was 37 years younger than Franklin. The committee accepted Franklin's edit, but John Adams was not satisfied with the result. He wanted to add words that reflected the other wing of Michael Novak's American Eagle, Calvinist Christianity. He asked that the committee add the sentence, "They are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights." In the spirit of compromise, Jefferson and the drafting committee, and ultimately the Continental Congress, accepted the amendments that both Franklin and Adams offered, resulting in the timeless words of the Declaration that have defined our national purpose and shaped our history since then. That was not the only compromise in the drafting of the Declaration of Independence. Take, for example, the section listing the misdeeds of the British Crown that justified the Americans' claim to independence. Jefferson originally included the charge that Britain had forced slavery on the colonies. The drafting committee accepted that wording. When it came before the full Congress, however, some of the delegates argued that this language went too far and would offend people in Britain who might otherwise support the American Revolution. In the interest of moderation, pragmatism, and unity, that charge against Britain was removed from the Declaration. As significant as these compromises were in leading to unanimous adoption of the Declaration of Independence, they were modest compared to the great differences that had to be bridged to reach agreement at the Constitutional Convention 11 years later. When the delegates left their home states for Philadelphia in May of 1787, there wasn't even unanimous consent about the purpose of the convention. A majority agreed that the Articles of Confederation were not working well, primarily because the states had too much power and the national government too little. But most of the delegates saw the convention only as an opportunity to modify the articles to achieve a bit more authority at the center of the U.S. government. A few delegates had larger goals. They wanted to abandon the articles and write a new constitution for a new, stronger national government. Alexander Hamilton of New York and James Madison of Virginia united in making this case in the Federalist Papers. With the support of the hero of the American Revolution, General George Washington, they ultimately prevailed. But it wasn't easy, and it required more than the force of the Federalist Papers' reasoned arguments and Washington's stature. It required hard, practical compromises to protect and strengthen their experiment in independent self-government. The states were, after all, very different from one another. There were large and small population states, and slave and free states. They had different ideas about how much power they should give the citizenry in the republic they were creating, and how much authority should be added to the new national government and taken from the state governments. Like all compromises, the great ones reached in Philadelphia at the Constitutional Convention were not perfect. Remember Voltaire's warning that the quest for perfection cannot be allowed to block the achievement of good results. In the end, the delegates wrote a constitution and strengthened America in a way that has sustained and guided our nation since. In fact, it changed the vision of government throughout the world. And it only happened because the delegates in Philadelphia came to the center and made difficult, imperfect compromises. First, most of the delegates ultimately accepted that it was necessary to write a new constitution for a new government, but they still had to work out their differences about its form and content, or they would not have the votes necessary to adopt a constitution and send it back to the states for ratification. When it came to the new national legislative body, there was a consensus that it should have two chambers. That was what the delegates were familiar with from Britain and had adopted in all of the states except Pennsylvania, which had a unicameral legislature. But how would they apportion representatives from the states to the new Congress? And how would they select the representatives? Those were very divisive questions. Large population states were pitted against small ones, slave states against free ones. The large population states naturally wanted representation in both chambers of Congress to be based on population. They were led by Virginia, which, together with Massachusetts and Pennsylvania, contained almost half of the young country's population. But the small population states at the convention, led by New Jersey, were larger in number, and they wanted each state to have equal representation in both chambers of Congress. Without their support, no constitution would be adopted at the convention. This dispute threatened to break up the convention and effectively end the American experiment. The delegates were gridlocked during the summer of 1787. The breakthrough came when the Connecticut delegation, led by Roger Sherman and Oliver Ellsworth, proposed what became known as the Connecticut Compromise. It was sensible and simple. Representation in the House would reflect the population of the states, but in the Senate, each state would have equal representation regardless of its population. Would enslaved Americans, who constituted 40% of the population of the southern states at that time, be counted in the apportionment of seats in the House? The Southerners wanted the slaves to be counted, but, of course, not to be freed. Many of the Northerners argued that if black slaves were to be counted, they should be liberated. James Wilson of Pennsylvania, appreciating that the larger population states like his, Massachusetts and Virginia, needed the support of some of the southern states to adopt a system of representation based on population, proposed that seats in the House be based on the free population plus 3/5 of the slave population. This dehumanizing compromise not only left slavery in America untouched, but gave the southern states about a dozen more seats in the Congress and a dozen more votes in the Electoral College. 9 states supported the 3/5 compromise. Only New Jersey and Delaware voted against it. The anti-slavery forces were upset by the 3/5 compromise and pressed for a ban in the Constitution on international slave trading into the U.S. In other words, although the Constitution would not alter the status of the current slave population, they wanted to legislate an end to the importation of more slaves. The southern states opposed that, and another compromise was reached. International slave trading would be banned in America, but not until 20 years later, at the earliest, in 1808. There were also various proposals for how to elect members of Congress, many of them not really democratic. Hamilton proposed that the House be elected for set terms by the voters, but that the Senate be elected for life by a new group called electors, who would be chosen by the state governments. Charles Pinckney of South Carolina recommended that members of the House should be elected by the people, and the Senate should then be elected by the House. Some argued that both chambers should be popularly elected, but that proposal was defeated in a vote. Then a compromise was offered to have the House popularly elected and the senators chosen by their state legislatures. That process was adopted and stayed in effect until the 17th Amendment, which required the popular election of U.S. senators, was ratified in 1913, more than 125 years later. It is important to understand that although the delegates to the Constitutional Convention wanted to create a republic based on classic liberal principles, they were also landed aristocrats who worried about what the citizenry might do if there were no limits on the new power they had in voting. Thus, they chose the state legislatures, which were generally controlled by establishment figures, to elect the members of the U.S. Senate, one layer removed from the voters. The delegates to the Constitutional Convention did the same when it came to the election of the president. First, they had to decide the basic question of what form the executive branch of their new government would take. There were some proposals made by great men in Philadelphia that seem very odd today. Hamilton proposed that electors would choose the president who would serve for life. Franklin proposed a plural executive of three people. And in his Virginia plan, Madison provided that the president would be chosen by Congress. James Wilson of Pennsylvania again listened, negotiated, and offered a compromise. He argued that a president chosen by Congress would be too dependent on the legislature and would not be a check on its power. So he recommended a unitary executive. Wilson's proposal gained support because many of the delegates had George Washington, who they had chosen to preside at the convention, in mind as their first president. A majority of the delegates still wanted the president to be popularly elected, and that worried a minority that feared who the voters themselves might choose as their president. So, again, there was gridlock. To break it with another centrist compromise, Wilson took Hamilton's idea of electors chosen by the states, which had been rejected for the selection of the members of the Senate, and proposed instead that the Constitution establish an electoral college, whose members would be chosen in the states and actually select the president. The voters in presidential elections would be voting for electors, presumably supporting a presidential candidate, not for the candidate himself. As the summer of 1787 was coming to a close, most of the big questions for the Constitution had reached a consensus. Then the convention chose a committee of detail, chaired by Benjamin Franklin, to bring it all together. And they did. For example, on the most difficult political question regarding the degree to which population would determine the selection of members of Congress, Franklin embraced the Connecticut Compromise, but sweetened it for the still dissatisfied large population states by proposing that the House, whose membership would be based on population, would have exclusive power to originate revenue bills and propose salaries for government workers. When Franklin presented his committee's agreed-upon language for the new Constitution to the convention, he reminded the delegates that he had come to the convention favoring a single House and no Senate. Now he was offering a very different compromise proposal, a change of opinion which he justified with a wonderful story from his earlier life. When we were young tradesmen in Philadelphia and we had joints of wood that didn't quite fit together, you'd take a little from one side and then shave a little from others until you had a joint that would hold together for centuries. And so, too, we here at this convention must each part with some of our demands if we're going to have a constitution that will hold together. Compromises may not make great heroes, Franklin said, but they do make great democracies. Franklin's statements are eternal truths that have been validated in American history at every point when our elected leaders have come together to protect our security increase our prosperity, and in many other ways, make ours a more perfect union. They did it compromise by compromise. That was certainly what I experienced in my 40 years in American government, an era when bipartisanship and compromise were much more achievable than today. Many times during gridlock, I would appeal to my colleagues in the U.S. Senate to look back at our Constitutional Convention and remember that our founders were capable of compromising as much as they did to establish our government, including in the very makeup of the Congress in which we were privileged to serve. Surely we could find a way to come together to solve the problem we were facing that day. 2. A personal case study. The sources of my centrism. My first political memory is Election Day in November 1952, when I was just 10 years old. My father, mother, grandmother, my mom's mom, who lived with us, and I were sitting in our house on Strawberry Hill Court in Stamford, Connecticut, watching the returns from the presidential election on our new television, which had a cabinet much bigger than the screen. The candidates were Republican Dwight Eisenhower and Democrat Adlai Stevenson. My grandmother and I were quite logically supporting Eisenhower. He was, after all, the great general who had led the American military to victory over Hitler's Nazi armies in Europe. As the evening went on, it became clear to me that my father and mother were supporting Stevenson, which puzzled and irritated me. But I was only 10, and besides, in the end, Ike won, and that was what counted. A few years later, I asked my dad how he possibly could have supported Stevenson over Eisenhower. Was it because he always supported the Democratic candidate? "Oh no," he answered. "I admired Eisenhower a lot, but I thought Stevenson was more ready, based on his experience as governor and his intellect, to be president. I don't always support the Democratic candidate if I think the Republican will do a better job. In fact, in 1940, I supported the Republican candidate, Wendell Willkie, instead of President Roosevelt, because I didn't think it was good for any president to serve more than two terms, even during a world war, and I thought Willkie was a very honorable, able, and independent-minded man." Needless to say, those paternal words, bipartisan, centrist, stuck with me. The 1952 election night was not the only way my parents influenced me to become a centrist, or, for that matter, to go into public service. They raised my sisters and me in a religiously observant home, where faith was the foundation of all we did. We believed in God, our Creator, Sustainer, and Redeemer. We saw our lives as the result of an intentional divine act, not an accident of nature. The same was obviously true of all lives, of every other person, which meant we should treat everyone as we hoped they would treat us. How do those beliefs connect to politics and centrism? If you see everyone you meet on the street or serve with in politics as a child of God, just as you are, it should lead you to treat them respectfully, listen to what they are saying, and try to better understand and learn from them. Those are the ingredients of centrism, and the opposite of the reflexes of partisans and extreme ideologues who view people in the other party, or of different ideologies, as enemies to be defeated, not as fellow human beings to engage, debate, and work with. My study of the Talmud added values and stories from the rabbis of old that also influenced me. One of the most important values I learned was the process by which the Talmud itself was composed. Discussion and disputation leading to a consensus in values and law. In other words, disagreements can be a good thing if they are made with mutual respect and open minds, because they usually lead to greater insights and understandings than an individual can reach alone. Take the following story I was taught from the Talmud, for example. It's about a great rabbi who regularly studied, learned, and argued matters of faith and law with another rabbi, who died suddenly. The surviving rabbi was heartbroken. His students worried about him and decided they should find another rabbi to be his new study partner. After a few days, the older rabbi told his students to never bring that new study partner to him again. "With my friend who has died," he said, "when I would make a point, he would find many reasons to question my position, which we would discuss and argue, and the result was a better conclusion between the two of us. I know this rabbi you brought to me is learned, but every time I propound a position, he finds only reasons to agree with me. That is not the way to help me or lead to the truth. That Talmudic ethic is an ideal precondition for centrism and problem-solving politics. So is civility. You are much more likely to be able to meet people of different views in the center if you have treated them civilly, and they have treated you that way as well. Here, too, religious tradition and my parents were great teachers and role models. The rabbis of the Talmud instructed the faithful to greet people with a smile, and, if you knew them, with a friendly, interested word. This was to be done not with an ulterior motive, but because it was the respect each of us owes our fellow human beings. My mom and dad lived by this rule, and it had an effect on my sisters and me. As I realized later when I became a parent, we teach our children as much or more by how we behave than by how we tell them to behave. In that way, my parents were great educators. My mom was a naturally warm, outgoing, and accepting person with the widest variety of friends. My dad was more cerebral and quieter, and that made it all the more impressive when I saw how warmly and civilly he greeted people in public and in his store. There is another side of civility, one closer to what used to be called manners, that I also grew up with. Both of my parents were raised in lower-income, one-parent families, and neither had the opportunity to go to college, but they were as refined in behavior and speech as any high-income college graduate I ever met. In our home, foul language, stories about improper subjects, and gossip about other people were not tolerated. Today, those taboos of my youth are publicly broken every day in political discourse. That, too, contributes to the difficulty politicians have finding their way to the problem-solving center. Coming to common ground begins with mutual trust, which is eroded when people in public life attack each other and spread stories, often false, about each other in language that is coarse and insulting. Just as I was blessed to have excellent personal teachers and role models, I was fortunate to have public heroes who motivated me into public service and helped shape my centrist politics. In 1954, when I was 12 years old, Abraham Ribicoff was elected governor of Connecticut, the first Jewish person to hold the highest office in our state's history. Ribicoff's election was a source of great pride, excitement, and optimism in the Lieberman household. The governor himself spoke of his election as the realization of the American dream. A few years later, when I was following current events more closely, I read a lot about Ribicoff and was particularly impressed that he titled his first State of the State address as governor, "The Integrity of Compromise." Ribicoff was a Democrat. The majority of both houses of the General Assembly were Republicans. Ribicoff said they would have to compromise to get anything done for the people who elected them. That kind of compromise was honorable and necessary, he argued. Coming to the center, Governor Ribicoff extended his hand to the Republicans in the General Assembly, and, to their credit, they took his hand and joined him there in a number of bipartisan accomplishments, including reforming the state's judicial system, eliminating outdated county governments, and increasing state government support for local public schools. Governor Ribicoff was connected to the other great political hero of my youth, John F. Kennedy. He and the longtime Connecticut Democratic Party chairman John M. Bailey supported then-Senator Kennedy from neighboring Massachusetts when he sought and lost the Democratic nomination for vice president in 1956 and stayed with him all the way to the White House in 1960. For many Americans of my generation, Kennedy was our inspiration and catalyst into public service. To me, his views were attractively balanced, liberal on social policy, moderate on economic policy, and conservative on foreign and defense policy. He was a proud Democrat, and also a centrist because he wanted to get things done. As he said right at the opening of his memorable inaugural address on January 20, 1961, "We observe today not a victory of party, but a celebration of freedom." The lessons I learned from my parents and my faith, together with the role models and heroes I had in Governor Ribicoff and President Kennedy, combined to arouse my interest in public service and my understanding of how to be an effective public servant, which was from the bipartisan center. In the fall of 1960, I left Stamford and, with my dad behind the wheel, traveled up I-95 to New Haven and Yale College. Like most freshmen, I had no idea about what I wanted to do when I graduated. I was just excited to be there, the first in my family to go to college, and anxious that I not flunk out and thereby embarrass my family and ruin my life. 7 years later, on a sunny day in June 1967, when I graduated from Yale Law School, if you'd asked me what I hoped to do in life, I wouldn't have given you the truthful answer because it seemed too presumptuous. I would have said that I was very happy to have a job with a wonderful old New Haven law firm, Wiggin and Dana. I might have added that one day I could go into public service. The unrevealed part of the answer was that I had a specific goal, really a dream, and that was to become a United States Senator. What happened during my 7 years as a Yale student that so dramatically clarified and raised my ambitions and planted that dream? First, I took some great courses in history, political philosophy, political science, and economics. I also did a lot of reading on my own, mostly history and biography, but also some political novels. Robert Penn Warren's All the King's Men was my favorite, and is one of the greatest American political novels ever. From this studying and reading, I came away with a growing appreciation of the large role leaders play, for good or bad, in the lives of the people at local and national levels. I also learned how the best leaders in democracies like America's, leaders like Washington, Lincoln, Theodore Roosevelt, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, and Harry Truman, achieved the most good. It was through important personal qualities like patriotism, principle, and persistence, together with a practical willingness to work with people who disagreed with them. Today, I would call that centrism. In 1962, after my sophomore year at college, I volunteered to work on the U.S. Senate campaign of Abe Ribicoff, who had returned to Connecticut after 2 years as Kennedy's Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare. During that summer, I attended the Connecticut State Democratic Convention, my first ever. Ribicoff was nominated over a liberal populist challenger, Congressman Frank Kowalski. Connecticut Party Chairman John Bailey was at the center of that convention, as he had been at every Democratic convention since the mid-1940s. His control of the nominating process at those conventions was usually conclusive, because primaries for nominations were not even legal in Connecticut until the mid-1950s, and the first statewide primary didn't happen until 1970. Watching Bailey operate at that 1962 convention fascinated me. He looked as if he had been sent from Hollywood to play the role of an old-time political boss, moving from delegate to delegate, glasses on his forehead, cigar in his hand, whispering to each, or sending an aide to ask a delegate to come for a discussion in the private room he had backstage at the convention hall. The more I asked people about John Bailey, the more their answers intrigued me. In some ways, he was actually like the old American political bosses in the power he exercised. But he did it differently. Bailey was a consensus builder, not a dictator. He had made a transition to a new generation of politics, embracing new groups. That year, he put an African-American man on the state ticket, a first for Connecticut, and using new campaign tools like public opinion polling. When Ribicoff defeated his challenger Kowalski for the nomination, Bailey offered Kowalski renomination as congressman at large, but he balked. He was angry that Ribicoff had returned from the Kennedy cabinet to take the Senate nomination away from him. The convention then went into recess for several hours, during which Bailey and others negotiated with Kowalski. The congressman threatened a first-ever statewide primary, made increasing demands, and refused to compromise. Bailey walked away from the negotiations, which was unusual for him, and directed his aides as follows. Get me 3 Polish-American Catholics who have good, clean records and, if possible, can speak Polish. We will interview them right now. From that process, Bernard Grabowski, a lawyer and former municipal judge from New Britain, emerged. He was nominated that night, elected in November, and served three successful terms in Congress. Frank Kowalski never held office again. I decided I wanted to do my senior paper at Yale on John Bailey. I applied for and was accepted to a unique program called Scholar of the House, to which a dozen seniors were admitted each year. It freed me from all course requirements to work with a faculty advisor on a project and readings before writing a thesis. I was very fortunate to be assigned to James David Barber, then a young faculty member at Yale, later to become a renowned professor of political science at Duke University. At the end of the year, my paper was submitted to a panel of three faculty members, who read it, questioned me, and graded it. One of them, William Lee Miller, was a graduate of the Yale Divinity School, teacher of political ethics at Yale and later at the University of Virginia, and a historian and prolific author. After reading my paper, Bill Miller contacted me to say he thought it was unique and should be published. If it was okay with me, he would send it to his publishers, Houghton Mifflin in Boston. I was grateful, excited by the possibility, and absolutely thrilled when Houghton Mifflin said they wanted to publish it, which they did in 1966 under the title The Power Broker. I recently looked back at that book and was surprised at how much my college study of John Bailey educated me and contributed to my later political life as a centrist. I began my senior paper and the book with a quote from Robert Penn Warren's All the King's Men, in which Willie Stark, the fictional governor of Louisiana, tells a reporter who becomes his chief aide, "One thing I understand and you don't is what makes the mayor, government, go. I can make the mayor go." That was John Bailey. He knew how to make the mayor go. He wanted Democrats to win elections and then get things done while they were in office so they could be reelected. I ended my book with some relevant conclusions about John Bailey. Bailey is temperamentally a competent centrist who views political issues as a technician, not as an ideologist. He is not at ease with zealous partisans of either right or left. This approach was reflected in Bailey's choice of candidates whom the Connecticut Democratic Party would support. As I observed then, with the cold and professional detachment of the surgeon he once thought he might be, his father was a doctor, Bailey goes about gauging popular sentiment. He becomes the unemotional receiver of feedback from the voting public, the computer absorbing data and then turning out the name of the candidate most likely to receive the vote of a majority of citizens. Bailey's personal attitudes have no place in these investigations or in his ultimate choice. The proof of that stoicism is the number of times Bailey supported people with whom he had disagreements. As Abe Ribicoff once told me, John has never allowed himself the luxury of revenge. Here are some other words I wrote at age 22 that bring a smile to my face now. Probably Bailey's most caustic critics within the Connecticut Democratic Party are liberals who charge him with bringing too many mediocre men to office, mediocre here seeming to mean more moderate than they would prefer. In fact, John Bailey did support many candidates who most people considered liberal in their time and were also high-quality public servants, including Governor Chester Bowles, Senator William Benton, Senator Abe Ribicoff, President Kennedy, and later Governor Ella Grasso. The deciding factor in his candidate selection process was never ideology, but who he believed had the best chance to get elected. As he said to me, "I go with the bird who can fly, not with the pigeon who can't get off the ground." Bailey had rules that enabled him to find those birds who could fly and then to help them soar. And he had what he called political feel. In the 1954 gubernatorial campaign, for example, he chose Abe Ribicoff as the breakthrough Democratic candidate for governor because he saw Ribicoff as a Yankee Jew who could receive support from the still large voting bloc of white, Protestant, moderate Republicans, while holding on to the surging number of working, middle-class, Roman Catholic, Democratic voters. His political feel in that case worked brilliantly, as it did for John F. Kennedy for president in 1960, and in 1974 for Ella Grasso, the first Italian-American governor in Connecticut history, and the first woman ever elected governor of any American state, not succeeding her husband. Another of Bailey's rules was to balance Democratic state tickets ethnically and religiously, and later racially and in gender. Congressman Grabowski was a beneficiary of that balancing. I once asked Bailey whether he still thought all that ticket balancing was necessary, and he answered, "To be honest with you, I really don't know, but we keep winning, don't we?" John Bailey was more involved in Democratic policy formation in the Connecticut legislature than most state political bosses of his time. He loved the legislative process and was a skilled negotiator and problem solver for Democratic governors. His goal was always to give his Democratic governors and legislators a good record to take into the next election. Those records of accomplishment were almost always centrist, because Bailey knew Connecticut was a competitive political state where the plurality of voters was registered as independents. John Bailey turned out to be invaluable in my education as a centrist. I graduated from Yale College in 1964 and was lucky to be admitted that fall to Yale Law School, which also contributed to my education as a centrist, but in very different ways. I learned about the compromises at the Constitutional Convention that were necessary to reach agreement to form our new country, and the negotiations in the legislative center that enabled the enactment of the most important laws in our history. I also was taught that laws enacted by legislators, enforced by lawyers, and adjudicated by courts are the embodiment of our aspirations for ourselves and our country. They are the expression of our best values, and the enactment of rules for behavior to achieve it. Laws say what we would like to be and should be, but are not yet. Without law, there would be chaos, violence, and probably societal self-destruction. The faculty at Yale Law was superb, spanning a large spectrum of political ideologies and legal philosophies. The student body was impressive and taught me a lot as well. Those lessons deepened my desire to be a lawyer and lawmaker, perhaps a law enforcer, and maybe even a judge. I also benefited greatly from my extracurricular activities while at Yale College and law school. As an undergraduate, I was a reporter on the Yale Daily News and eventually became the editor, called chairman of the board at Yale. As such, I spent a lot of time with a wonderful group of classmates who wrote for the Yale Daily, two of whom became managing editors of great American newspapers, Paul Steiger at the Wall Street Journal and Bob Kaiser at the Washington Post. As chairman, so the tradition held, I wrote all the editorials. Although I used we, it was me who had to learn enough about issues in the world, our country, and on campus to take policy positions. And I would say that during my year as chairman, our newspaper's editorial policies are best described as center-left. 36 years later, in 2000, as part of Vice President Gore's vetting of me as a possible running mate, a Washington lawyer went back and read all of my Yale Daily News editorials to make sure I had not taken any positions that would come back to hurt the Gore ticket if I were selected. I was later told that the three most controversial editorial positions he found were appeals for civil rights for African Americans, co-education for the still all-male Yale College, and the opening of diplomatic relations between the United States and a country I called Red China. In 2000, the Gore vetting team fortunately concluded that none of those editorial positions would compromise my possible candidacy for vice president, nor would the fact that during college I got personally involved in the civil rights movement, first in New Haven in protest against low-income housing policies. Then, during the summer of 1963, while I was a summer intern for Senator Ribicoff in Washington, I joined in the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom behind Dr. Martin Luther King. I was at the Lincoln Memorial on that summer afternoon when Dr. King delivered his I Have a Dream speech, one of the great orations in American history. It was built on the centrist American foundation of religious faith and values. When I returned to New Haven, I wrote about that influential experience in the Yale Daily. Soon thereafter, Yale's chaplain, William Sloan Coffin, challenged me to use my position as chairman of the Yale Daily News to organize and lead a group of Yale students to Mississippi to join in a mock freedom vote election to protest the disenfranchisement of African Americans there, 100 years after the Civil War. It was a thrilling, threatening, and ultimately transformational experience, which taught me what it meant to be a leader and gave me the special feeling of satisfaction that comes from serving a cause larger than oneself. It was quite an education I received inside and outside the classrooms at Yale, and during two Mr. Lieberman Goes to Washington summer intern experiences working with Senator Abe Ribicoff in 1963 and Democratic National Chairman John Bailey in 1964. By 1964.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.